Let's talk about Israel, because the biggest news of the week has obviously been this.
This morning, the worst violence in years between Israelis and Palestinians is intensifying. Israel's military attacked new targets in Gaza, the Palestinian territory where militants are firing hundreds of rockets into Israel. And in the Israeli-occupied West Bank, Palestinian protesters fought with police.
Since Monday, over 80 Palestinians have been killed and 7 Israelis in this tit-for-tat war.
Okay, there is a lot to unpack there, from the horror of the situation, which has escalated significantly since then, to the use of the phrase tit-for-tat war in a conflict where you just pointed out one side has suffered over 10 times the casualties. Something which speaks to both the severe power imbalance at play here and how that often gets obscured by how we choose to talk about it. And look, if you are not fluent in Middle East history, I know this can seem overwhelming. The latest chapter in a long story you haven't read. So I'm not going to try and recap the history here, or indeed propose a solution, although interestingly, I do have one, because someone with this accent always thinks they can fix things in the Middle East. I redrew the map a bit, and I have a lot of misplaced confidence that it would work very well. But this week's actually been a pretty good reminder that while some things are incredibly complex and require a great deal of context, others are just wrong. Take, for instance, one of the incidents that's been a flashpoint, the planned expulsion of Palestinians who've lived in the Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood for generations. It's currently tied up in the Israeli court system, with the foreign ministry calling it a real estate dispute. But it's worth knowing that the UN's Commissioner for Human Rights has said that these expulsions would violate Israel's obligations under international law. So it is not hard to see why sanitized terms like evictions or property disputes rankle those who live there.
You grew up in the neighborhood. Your family home is slated for eviction. What is the scene right now?
Well, I thank you so much for having me. To start, it's not really an eviction. It's forced ethnic displacement, to be accurate. Eviction does not imply the hundreds and hundreds of heavily armed police and army and settlers for looting, blowing up your doors, throwing your children from your windows, and using brute force to throw you out in the street and assaulting and arrest you should you resist. It doesn't imply the grenades, it doesn't imply the rubber-coated bullets.
Right. The threat of eviction is accurate only in a very superficial level, in that one day you live somewhere, the next day you don't, and that change wasn't your choice. But it doesn't tell the whole story. It's like running a headline that says, Matt Gaetz reaches out to Florida youth. Sure. Not inaccurate, but it's missing some pretty crucial details about the exact nature of that interaction. And look, it is true that militants from Palestinian groups like Hamas fired over 1,000 rockets towards Israel this week, and that is reprehensible. But, and I realize this is the most load-bearing conjunction in history, but the majority of those rockets thankfully didn't reach their target for a very clear reason.
The casualties and the damage would have been greater, but for Israeli interceptor rockets, the so-called Iron Dome, which blew most of the incoming missiles to pieces.
Yeah, Israel has a so-called Iron Dome. And I know, what if we blew up the rockets with more rockets? Sounds like something someone drunkenly wrote down on a napkin once, but it is a real military defense system that really works. And I also know, not all the rockets were shot down. Israeli civilians were killed this week, which is terrible. But the point is, this isn't tit for tat. There is a massive imbalance when it comes to the two sides' weaponry and capabilities. While most of the rockets aimed toward Israeli citizens this week were intercepted, Israel's airstrikes were not. They hit their targets, including a house in a refugee camp, a building housing the Associated Press and Al Jazeera, and this 13-story office and apartment building. And while Israel insisted that there were military targets in that building and that they destroyed it as humanely as possible, even warning people to evacuate beforehand, for the record, destroying a civilian residence sure seems like a war crime, regardless of whether you send a courtesy heads-up text. And when dozens of people have seen their homes or livelihoods destroyed, it doesn't really help that the Israeli military posted this triumphant meme showing the explosion and the rubble labeled before and after. Look what we did. People lived there before and now they can't. You get it, right? And obviously, in general, you should probably never meme a war crime. But if you absolutely have to, at least go with something less boring than the before-after template. Maybe use the Drake meme or the disaster girl. There's a building coming down, so checkmark already there. And it's a little girl with eyes that scream, I don't know what the Geneva Conventions are, and frankly, I don't care. The more I think about it, it works perfectly.